You may be seated. On behalf of all my colleagues, I want to extend my warm welcome to this baccalaureate worship service. We welcome the class of 2017, their family, friends, people who have gathered for this very special occasion. It's our custom at Gordon that we gather for a worship service as a community, a chance for us to come together and to recommit our lives to the Lord at the start of a very special weekend of joy and celebration. In some ways, baccalaureate marks the end of our time of worshiping together as a family, as the class of 2017 goes forth from this place. But in other ways, it represents the new beginning of opportunities to places where God might call you going forth from this place. 1 Thessalonians 2:8 says, "We were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well because you've become so dear to us." That's how we feel about you, class of 2017. We're excited to be here to celebrate this special occasion. God bless you as we begin this special weekend. Now, will you please rise for the invocation and call to worship?
A reading from Psalm 105, verses 1 through 4. Give praise to the Lord, proclaim his name, make known among the nations what he has done. Sing to him, sing praises to him. Tell of all of his wonderful acts. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts who seek the Lord rejoice. Look to the Lord and his strength. Seek his face always. Let us pray. Father, it is with abundant praise that we come before you today. We thank you for this season of celebration. We are truly grateful, Lord, to share this moment with our friends and family. God, we praise you for all the work you have done, are doing, and will do in each of our lives. It is only through your faithfulness and constant provision that we are here today. And God, we acknowledge that you have been with us every step of our journey, and that you are here with us now in this new stage of life. And God, we pray that during this time, we would become aware of your presence, that we, as the psalmist said, will continually learn to seek your face always, in this moment and in the next. We pray that you are honored and lifted high by this gathering of your people. We pray that you bless our speakers and our time together. It is through the power of your Spirit and in your precious Son's resurrected name we pray. Amen. Please remain standing for the opening hymn.
Thank you. Good evening. At the end of each academic year, I have the privilege of presenting an award for Collegian of the Year at our annual Honors Convocation. This award is selected by faculty and staff for a student who has made the greatest contribution to the college throughout their college career. At this year's Honors Convocation, our recipient sadly could not be with us because she was honoring the legacy of her grandmother, who passed away that week. And so we thought it would be more fitting to honor her in the presence of her peers and her family today. This year's recipient is a psychology major, neuroscience minor. She's our first female Clarendon Scholar to receive Collegian of the Year. She has been a scholar, a leader, and a servant at Gordon College. She served as a resident assistant and apartment coordinator in residence life for 3 years. She's been a peer mentor to many of our students for the Great Conversation as well as in the Clarendon program. She served in the provost's office this year as a presidential fellow. She's completed research with Dr. Audet and Dr. Shore and Dr. Brink and taught Sunday school at Baraka Evangelical Baptist Church. In her spare time, she's traveled to China and Hong Kong for internships, led missions trips. She's led and participated in worship bands for chapel, for local churches, and in the gospel choir, and she can play a mean cajon. She is the kind of woman that I hope my own daughters will emulate. And so it is my privilege to give this award, Collegian of the Year, to a very deserving young woman, Sahenga DePestre.
Ladies and gentlemen, parents and families, distinguished guests, staff, faculty, and fellow students, welcome to this momentous occasion where we are given the opportunity to reflect not only on what has been, but what is to come. In my 5 years at Gordon College, I have been blessed with opportunities to learn and discover things about the world that I never could have imagined. I walked through dusty London streets in my British literature classes. I went on a life-changing journey as I studied Elizabeth Elliot's Through the Gates of Splendor. I learned about injustice and the capacity for human love and mercy in my theology classes. I learned that I have a calling. I learned that I have a purpose. I learned in a world full of brokenness, Christ is the light that shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. The people that have invested in me over these years have forever changed my life. But ultimately, it is you, my fellow students, which have taught me the most. In the words of famed orator Bilbo Baggins, "I don't know half of you half as well as I should like, and I like less than half of you half as well as you deserve." You all have taught me that community and commitment to community is the only way that we will have an impact on this world. This evening, I would like to briefly touch on two prayers I have for all of us. For the first prayer is that we will not forget these years. These years have been hard. These years have been character forming, but one day when we're older, we will look back on these memories with a vague fondness, a fondness that ignores the challenges that we overcame. I pray that you meditate often on the challenges you overcame to be in this room wearing this cap and gown right now. It is within these challenges that we find a story. When we find a story, we find a witness to the power and love of Christ that is unique, personal, and life-changing. These stories have the power to produce hope. Romans 5 says, "We rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character. Character produces hope, and hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit." I pray that we will not be put to shame as we go forward into the world, bearing these struggles together and becoming a glorious witness for the world. My second prayer involves commitment. Commitment is so much more than just sticking with something. Commitment means to believe in an idea so fiercely and with such strong desire that in the face of trials and tribulations, the idea stands as a strong pillar for us to lean on. The idea I'm referring to here is the idea of the church. The church is, in fact, one of the most ridiculous ideas we've ever heard of. It's an idea that asks us to give our lives to one another, an idea that asks us to follow a poor carpenter towards redemption, and it's the idea that faithful Christian love and truth stand in the face of a world that is happy to be non-committal and transient. Brothers and sisters, believe in that idea. Believe that Christ is looking upon us as we struggle to carry out this idea with love and joy. Look at the people right now around you. Commit to them. Commit to pray for them. Commit to looking at who they are, a person bearing the image of God. Dr. Cornel West says, we have to recognize that there cannot be relationships unless there is commitment, unless there is loyalty, unless there is love, patience, and persistence. The church needs to take this to heart. Commit to the idea that the church can bring good change to this world. Remember what has been done for you and lay down your life, your gifts, and your conveniences to commit to the greatest idea of all. My time at Gordon will forever be remembered as the most rewarding, challenging, and joyful period of my life. Thank you all for being a part of making me the woman I am now. Thank you for committing to me, even if you didn't know you were. You have changed me, but I am just one woman. Our world is full of men and women suffering and longing for the power of the gospel to restore them. The restoration of this world cannot be done alone, and it can't even be done by groups of particularly extraordinary people. Restoration asks us to come to the table with what we have learned, with our abilities and God-given gifts, and be part of an amazing idea. Restoration is a messy process that requires the power of the Holy Spirit at every moment, but it is not impossible. Take what you've learned and change others for the church. Change others for Christ. Believe the hope of John chapter 1, verse 5. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Thank you.
The great lyricist Kendrick Lamar wrote a song that became an anthem of a movement. Some would claim it has the same unifying effect as Joan Baez leading a crowd in singing, "We Shall Overcome." The chorus of the song begins with a phrase that acknowledges that there are many sides to a story, and often we only have one of them. The next line touches upon the importance of taking a friend aside and expanding their worldview. Following this, the song portrays the sovereignty of our God played out through the beautiful people he has placed in our lives. Kendrick closes his anthem entitled, "All Right," with a reassurance that the future will be bright. The chorus goes, "I messed up, homie, you messed up, but if God's got us, then we gonna be all right. Do you hear me? Do you feel me? We gonna be all right." The first line, "I messed up." It was the summer before my freshman year when I opened up my housing letter. I'd been placed in a quad in Nyland with three other guys, one from New York, one from Oregon, and one from China. I would be lying to you if I told you that I wasn't a bit nervous and had my reservations about living with an international roommate. Never had I met anyone from China. In fact, the only Asian person I knew was my teammate from high school, and he was Vietnamese. Before meeting my roommate, I had already made assumptions about who he was and what living with him would be like. I messed up. We have all made assumptions before getting to know someone. We came into Gordon with a single story of how the world works and what the people who inhabit it are like. However, over the past 4 years, we have been given the opportunity to expand that world, that story. Jason taught me a lot that year. I learned about his hometown, his family, his travels. I learned what made Jason, Jason. Throughout my time at Gordon, I have benefited greatly from the endless conversations about cultural similarities and differences at the dinner tables on Darkside, in the booths in Chester's, both located in the Lane Student Center. That one is for our guest. We as a class have not only sat and listened to one another here at Gordon, but we've also traveled together and seen the diversity of our country and world through mission trips, service learning trips, internships, or just under other adventures. I messed up. The next line, homie, you messed up. My sophomore year, someone asked to touch my hair. To some of you, this may not seem like a big deal. For me, as a black man, it is. Because touching my hair is often followed with objectifying comparisons, some of the worst being moss on a rock or sheep's wool, both of which are incomparable to human hair. Yep, homie, you messed up. Gordon has given us the opportunity to meet people from all over, which has given us the space to not only mess up, but to reconcile. And though we don't agree on everything, we have learned to stay engaged even amongst those disagreements. We have sat and processed together, reminding each other that the best narratives often have more than one side to the story. Through addressing our differences in a constructive way, we've learned to have difficult conversations around contemporary issues like race, gender, and sexuality. We have made it our goal to always walk towards reconciliation, never away from it. I messed up, homie, you messed up. The next line, but if God's got us, then we gonna be all right. Throughout my 4 years here, I have been a member of the gospel choir. The gospel choir has been a place where students from a variety of ethnic backgrounds can come together and praise the Lord. As one can imagine, we spent most of our practices learning and singing songs. However, at the end of every practice, we would intentionally spend time reading the word, sharing testimonies, and giving prayer requests. There were some practices where we would stay a half hour longer because over half the choir had a prayer request, ranging from academic help to financial burdens to mental stability. Immediately after all requests were given, we would pray fervently for each one and then would wait for God to make that request a testimony. We can all attest to the fact that college is difficult. Throughout it, we've lost family members, we've lost friends, and we've questioned our own ability to succeed. As we studied for tests and wrote papers, the world outside of Gordon faced unspeakable tragedies, leaving us in a place of hopelessness. But if God's got us, then we gonna be all right. Now, let me be clear. We would not be the seniors we are today without God, of course, and the wonderful people he has helped mold us, who have helped mold us and care for us. These people include the wonderful full-time and adjunct professors who have tirelessly poured wisdom onto us. The excellent staff and administrators who have been a place of refuge when the world seemed to be falling apart. And the wise family members, friends, and significant others who kept us grounded in our values, reminding us to be true to ourselves. It is with God and the community we have surrounded ourselves with that reassure us that it's going to be all right. I messed up, homie, you messed up, but if God's got us, then we gonna be all right. The last line, do you hear me, do you feel me? We gonna be all right. I have no more stories, but class of 2017, I leave you with the words of Psalm 21-7. Do you get it? 21-7. May the Lord answer you when you are in distress. May the name of God, of the God of Jacob, protect you. May he send help from the sanctuary and grant you support from Zion. May he remember all your sacrifices and accept your burnt offerings. May he give you the desires of your heart and make all your plans succeed. May we shout for joy over your victory and lift our banner in the name of our God. May the Lord grant all your requests. Now this I know, the Lord gives victory to his anointed. He answers him from his heavenly sanctuary with the victorious power of his right hand. Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we trust in the name of the Lord our God. Class of 2017, do you hear me? Do you feel me? Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we trust in the name of the Lord our God. So we gonna be all right. Yeah, we gonna be all right.
The Lord is my light and my salvation.
Господь свет мой и спасение мое.
Whom shall I fear?
The Lord is the stronghold of my life.
La fortaleza de mi vida.
Of whom shall I be afraid?
When the wicked advance against me to devour me. It is my enemies and my foes who will stumble and fall.
Tropezarán y caerán. Though an army besiege me, my heart will not fear. Though war break out against me, even then I will be confident.
安稳。不断地接着。
Confidence.
One thing I ask from the Lord, this do I only seek. That I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life.
To gaze on the beauty of the Lord.
And
to seek him in his temple.
For in the day of trouble, he will keep me safe in his dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of his sacred tent.
Yo cantaré y alabaré al Señor.
And set me high upon a rock.
Then my head will be exalted above the enemies who surround me.
At his sacred tent, I will sacrifice with shouts of joy.
I will sing and make music to the Lord.
你口口人在里面的心里就会听啊。
我要唱诗歌颂耶和华。
Cantaré y haré música para el Señor.
Ставлю петь и воспевать перед Господом.
I will sing and make music to the Lord.
Hear my voice when I call, Lord.
耶和华，我用声音呼吁的时候，求你垂听。
Be merciful to me and answer me.
Помилуй меня и внемли мне.
My heart says this of you: seek his face.
Busca su rostro.
寻求他的面.
Ищите лица моего.
Your face, Lord, I will seek. I remain confident of this.
Confident.
Confident.
I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living.
Wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart.
当壮胆，坚固你的心。
Sé fuerte y confía en tu corazón.
And wait for the Lord.
Y espera al Señor.
And wait for the Lord.
要等候耶和华。
And wait for the Lord.
Уджутаєрезуйтека.
And wait for the Lord.
Надійся на Господа.
Yes, wait for the Lord.
Please rise as we affirm our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again and ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please remain standing for the New Testament lesson.
The New Testament lesson is from Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 to 14. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and understanding, he made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ to be put into effect when the times reach their fulfillment, to bring unity to all things in heaven and on earth under Christ. In him we were also chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will, in order that we, who were the first to put our hope in Christ, might be for the praise of his glory. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession, to the praise of his glory. You may be seated.
A native Texan, Don Stevens is the founder and president of Mercy Ships, a global faith-based organization bringing hope and healing to the world's poor, using state-of-the-art hospital ships to provide free, life-saving surgeries for people where medical care is inaccessible. Founded in 1978, Mercy Ships has delivered medical care in 55 developing nations, providing services valued at more than $1.3 billion, and treating more than 2.5 million people. As founder, Mr. Stevens continues to inspire a workforce of over 1,000 professional volunteers from 43 nations, with offices in 16 nations. Three events in his life inspired him to start Mercy Ships. The first, in 1964, was the human suffering he witnessed following a hurricane. The second was the birth of his profoundly disabled son, John Paul. The third was a brief encounter with Mother Teresa of Calcutta. His honors and awards include a U.S. Congressional Gold Medal nomination, the Points of Light Award, the Varsity Club International Humanitarian of the Year, the Commanders of the Republic Award from the Republic of Benin, and from the Food for the Hungry, the Two Hungers Award. He and his wife, Dayan, have 4 grown children and 5 grandchildren. We are honored to have him here tonight as our baccalaureate preacher. Please join me in welcoming to Gordon, Mr. Don Stevens.
Class of 2017, your parents and siblings, all the faculty, Dr. Michael and Rebecca, it's an honor to be here. When Michael first asked me if I would consider this, I was scared to death. What am I going to say to a group of graduating seniors from such an influential and prestigious school? Well, I think they were scraping at the bottom of the barrel, so bear with me and we'll get through this, all right? You're a wonderful group. In 1977, it was my first trip to Calcutta, India, at the invitation of a college university classmate of mine, Dr. Ron Shaw, to come to Calcutta and spend 10 days. Now, Mother Teresa was in the news weekly, if not more often. In 1973, she had been awarded the Templeton Prize. In 1979, 2 years after I visited with her, she would receive the Nobel Prize. Everybody in the world knew Mother Teresa, and I was going to be in Calcutta. Never mind that there are 30 million people there, I thought she should be easy to find. This little diminutive ethnic Albanian nun who was changing the world by serving Jesus. I mentioned this to my friend Dr. Ron Shaw. I didn't know that their hospital provided gratis service for the people that the Sisters of Charity served there in Calcutta. I mentioned it to Ron. The next morning he came back to me, or later that afternoon he came back to me and said, "Don, I have a meeting with Mother Teresa tomorrow morning really early, about 7 o'clock. Then I was scared to death. Can you identify? What am I going to say to Mother Teresa? I'm thinking to myself, why did I open my mouth? Why did I say that? So it's been my custom for years to carry 3x5 cards in the inside jacket pocket, and I got those cards out when I was back in my room, and I wrote out question after question. I had a very sleepless night. I tore most of the cards up. Finally, I had 2 or 3 questions. The next morning, with Mother Teresa, very simple room, 4 chairs, 4 straight wooden cane-backed, cane-seated chairs, Mother Teresa and another sister, the person that was with me, and myself. I got my cards out and I started. The first question was something like, how did you begin? How did you start? Mother Teresa reached out and gently but firmly pushed my hand with these cards away. She said, well, I want to answer another question about me. I've actually prayed for this meeting, and I want to ask you some questions. Well, now I was scared. What's this woman know about me? You know how the human mind works? That's where most of us would go, right? Her first question, I knew that she was very direct. I'd read that about her. First question, the directness stunned me. Don, why were you born? And that's the title of my thoughts for you, class of 2017. Why were you born? Well, I struggled, I stammered. Mother Teresa, there was, in addition to her directness, there was a graciousness. So she started to help me. Why do you think God put you on earth? Well, that didn't help me all that much. What's your dream? What's your purpose? And so I found myself, because I was trapped with her directness and also her winsomeness, I found myself articulating for the first time a dream that I had of a hospital ship serving Africa's poorest. It wasn't well presented. I'd written it out on a yellow foolscap, a legal pad. So I told her about my dream for a hospital ship serving Africa. Now, how Mother Teresa responded is amazing to me. Let me tell you what she didn't say. Are you a doctor? No. It was already incredible, but had she asked that, it would have gone downhill further. Are you from a maritime family? No, she didn't. She paused and she said something about, that's a very big dream. Something like, that was 40-some years ago. I couldn't quote it again. Something like, that's an amazing dream, or it's a huge dream. Her second question was equally as direct. And I think it applies to the class of 2017. Where is your pain? Where's there pain in your life? Well, I grew up in the mountains of Colorado. My mother are all Norskis, Norwegians. My father are German and Irish, mixed. In my culture, which is not too different from the East Coast culture here in New England, is men don't talk about pain. What do you mean, where's my pain? I remember my father saying to me many times as a boy, suck it up, get over it. Don't cry. What's wrong with boys crying anyway? Where is your pain? And again, not sure how to answer or what to say, Mother Teresa began to help me. She said, in my theology, we have an understanding that God often, not always, often uses pain as a preparation for the purpose that he has for us. So where's your pain? That's a big dream. Where is the pain in your life? So again, I don't trust people all that easily or readily, but in this situation I found myself quickly trusting Mother Teresa. So I told her about the third point that you mentioned, the birth of our special needs son. I have a daughter and then three boys. The middle boy, John Paul, who was just about a year old at the time, was on a different timetable, a different schedule. He had autism. He had some other things that had happened prior to his birth. Medicine doesn't really know why John Paul is a special need. We do not have a reason of what happened to John Paul. So I began to tell her, John Paul will be 41 this September. So I'm talking about something that happened a long time ago at the very beginning of the journey that I was on that's similar to the journey ahead of each of you. John Paul has four signs that he learned when he was about eight. First sign is, this is how he gives his name with his left hand. He's left-handed, he beats his chest. That means John Paul, or it means I'm a part of this. It means a lot of things. Second sign is, this is eat. With his left hand, he puts his fingers to his lips. Feed me, I'm hungry. Drink is a similar sign, turns it over. The fourth sign is on. He uses this for any number of things, as does his name, like, let's get with the program, I'm bored. He communicates with us. Dion and I have earned doctorates, in my opinion, in learning to read nonverbal communication because of our son, John Paul. So I told Mother Teresa that the source of my pain as a young father, not at all expecting or planning for a special needs child, was in this little boy. And in that meeting, I gained an understanding that perhaps the sovereign God that we sung about in that wonderful German hymn, Lobe den Herrn, it moved me to tears. Perhaps he was going to use John Paul to help me pursue the dream that he put in my heart. The third question was just as direct. She said to me, what are you doing about your dream? A lot of people came to Calcutta but didn't and told her about dreams. Evidently, that's what she said. But she said, a lot of them don't ever do anything about your dream. What are you doing about it? I want to come back to that in just a minute. She arranged for me to go to a center for the handicapped, one of their numerous homes. So another sister took us to this home, the person that was with me, and that was in 1976 in September, 77 in September. I can still close my eyes and bring the visages, the images of the special needs people that the Sisters of Charity, Mother Teresa, were caring for. It was feeding something within me that I still don't know how to articulate. It was like our Father in heaven was saying, this little boy will help you care and serve for people like this. So back with Mother Teresa just before we left, she reiterated the story, the question, what are you doing about it? So I flew home to be with Dion and our family. We were living in a rented home in Switzerland. I told her about my time with Mother Teresa, and I said, Dion, she asked me, what are we doing about it? And I didn't know how to answer. So we contacted some friends of ours, made a few phone calls, and about 3 weeks later, we were looking for used ocean liners to convert into hospital ships to serve Africa. Now, where are you going to go look for used ocean liners? You know, there's not a used car lot that sells used ocean liners. Through some friends of ours that are still friends today, in fact, we had email from them last night and this morning. They owned a shipping company. They opened the doors to us for the shipping world. And long story short, we found an ideal 20-year-old classic Italian liner that would take about 700 people. We never put that many on it. It was a combination cargo passenger ship. It was in very good condition, being only 20 years old, and we purchased it for $1 million with a loan for almost that much from Union Bank of Switzerland. And that's the beginning of the story that is now Mercy Ships. Sounds simple, doesn't it? Anything but. But what we've learned is that God has his people at every corner to help us on this journey. Why were you born? Where's there pain in your life? And what are you doing about it? Well, I'm convinced for all of you, class of 2017, I'm sure you've thought a lot about this, and for those of you that haven't, you're there anyway, you're at a crossroads. Google, when we put on Google Maps to come here, gave us a different word that we wouldn't use in the Midwest. We would say, you're at a fork of the road. No, this said, you're at, no, it's fork of the road. We would say you're at a crossroads. There's a fork in the road ahead of each of you. The one direction is for you to pursue significance. The other direction is for you to pursue success. And our society defines those differently. Success is how much money you make, how many degrees you have behind your name, kind of prestige you have, the level of power. It's one road. The other road, significance, is largely defined by the people you serve, the friends you make, the impact that you leave in others' lives. And I would suggest to you, class of 2017, that in your life, if not now, those roads will merge. I've seen time and time again, those who graduated from university were beginning to pursue success, but all of a sudden they learned that their success enabled their dream of significance. And I've seen the opposite. Those who were pursuing significance through service to others, that service to others provided the success financially and opened doors and contacts around the world. So my question to all of you, very personally, why were you born? Yes, you have the degree. Are you going to pursue other degrees? Yes, it's a wonderful school, a renowned, world-class school that you've graduated from with incredible faculty and leadership. As you're at the fork of the road, remember, God has a purpose for each of you. And in closing, I want to wrap all this together into Scripture, Jeremiah chapter 5. It's not in the program. I had it in my heart and mind as soon as I began to think and pray about this. Jeremiah, 700 years before the birth of Jesus, as an old man, most Bible scholars think, is writing of the early beginnings. And he starts, there's a word of God, there's an awareness in Jeremiah at the end of his life as he's writing about the beginning of his life. God said to him, I knew you before you were formed in the womb. I knew you before you were born. He goes on to say, because Jeremiah pushes back, I'm young, what will I say, what will I speak, where will I go, what will I do? And the Lord says to him, remember, the God who knew you, the God who put a dream, the God who put a purpose, the God who put why was I born deep within every one of you, is the God who is watching you and will enable you, class of 2017, as you go about the rest of your life. May the Lord bless you and add his blessings to each of you as you travel. Thank you.
Seniors, please stand. It's my privilege to be able to pray for you, as I have over these past 4 years, and will continue to as you leave this place. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, tonight we are here to worship you and celebrate your love and your faithfulness. We're also here to celebrate the hard work and accomplishments of these graduates and the many people who have made this moment possible. We thank you for the families, friends, and countless others who have loved prayed for, sacrificed, and worked hard to make this moment a reality for these graduates. Thank you for the many teachers, faculty, staff, administration who have challenged and cared for, taught, and encouraged each one of these students along their academic journey. And thank you for the lifelong friendships forged at Gordon. We praise you for the learning, the growth, the laughter, the tears, the burdens shared, and the opportunity to walk this season of life together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for each one of these graduating seniors. We thank you for their presence, your presence in each of their lives and their willingness to serve you. And in that service, may they always know and rely on the love that you have for them. Give these men and women courage to follow you as they go from this place, prepared and equipped to be the light of Christ in the world. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Now I'd like to invite everyone to stand as we sing together.
Institutions merged, Gordon College and Barrington College. Candle lighting during the baccalaureate service was part of the Barrington tradition, and now it is a welcome tradition for us at Gordon College. You will watch a light pass among tonight's honored seniors. This is surely a symbolic act. But symbolic of what?
Certainly, light can signify the illumination you've received during these years of concentrated study, for you have joined the long university tradition and having your minds enlightened. Light can also be a sign of overcoming obstacles throughout these years. Yes, your maturity shines before us. Surely, light also represents your commitment to friendships and burgeoning love nurtured here. Yet these are not the only forms of illumination that we mark this evening. To all gathered here, at Gordon College, our commitment to your sons and daughters, your grandsons and granddaughters, your brothers and sisters, your relatives and friends, is to keep the light of Jesus Christ shining. He who called himself the light of the world, and he of whom the gospel proclaims, in him was life, and the life was the light of people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. In his Confessions, Augustine captures his study of the liberal arts with a beautiful image. It goes like this. Learning in the liberal arts is like being brightly illuminated by God. Yet before he was a Christian, he had his back to the light and his face only toward those illuminating thoughts and ideas. He did not realize the source of the light, nor, in spite of all his learning, was his face reflecting the light. Following his conversion, he describes himself as incandescent. He not only saw the light reflected in his studies, but now he turned his face to the light. We are here tonight because of the light of Jesus Christ, the ultimate demonstration of God's grace by the power of the Spirit. All other illuminations from your time here at Gordon stem from this one light, Jesus Christ. Tonight, as we pass this light, we bear witness to Christ's ongoing redemptive activity among us. It is a sign pointing ourselves to him, beyond ourselves to him, whom we love and serve with all the strengths of our minds and hearts. What we learned and studied here within the celebrated tradition of Christian liberal arts education, we do so with Christ as the center. For this reason, we, like Augustine, turn our faces towards Christ with joy. I pass the light of Christ tonight, praying God's richest grace upon us all. May God receive all glory and honor. Representatives from all various majors will be lighting the candles. Seniors, please rise. Candle holders, please assume your positions.
Thank you. Would everyone please stand for the benediction? May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. Please stay standing for the recessional.